शिक्षा भैया बढ़ाई गई फोन तो चल रहा है।
हेलो गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, वी वुड बी स्टार्टिंग द प्रोसीडिंग्स एट 4:30 शार्प। देयर स्टिल 6 मिनट्स टू गो। देयर वुड बी एन ऑप्शन फॉर अनम्यूटिंग। वंस द स्पीकर हैज टू स्पीक, देयर वुड बी अ लिंक गिवन टू अनम्यूट हिमसेल्फ और हरसेल्फ।
Get ready. First addressed by Honorable Secretary. After them,
good evening, my Lord.
Good afternoon. And I must say, before I thank Mr. Singla and the President and the entire team, I must wish Mr. Gupta good afternoon. And sir, you know, this is the biggest honor and a pleasure for me. We all have been running to places to see you argue. We all have been crowding places to hear you. And, you know, I can't even express that what a moment it is for me in my life where I see you, attending a webinar in which I've been asked to speak. So I think this is one of the biggest, one of the best days of my life. So good to see you, sir. And good to see all my younger colleagues and all the members of the bar and all my friends. And I think the webinar team, Mr. Dillo and Mr. Singla, have taken special, initiative in doing this. And we are thankful to them and the entire team and the entire members of the bar that we can connect with them after having come on this side. So I think a lot of my younger colleagues also I see, they're all there. So I haven't seen them in a while. This happens sometimes, you know. So the best part is that our bar is so varied that I have been on the criminal side now for the last more than a month. Am I audible?
Please, my Lord.
You can hear me?
Please, my Lord.
I've been on the criminal side for more than a month and a half. And I actually miss some people who were, you know, civil stalkers and people, those who are doing great work. So the good part is that there is our bar, and there is so much of varied work. And so many members you get to interact with when you're on a particular roster. Mm-hmm. So although we do miss the ones on the other side, but let's hope this will keep circulating and this will keep changing so that we can interact with all the members.
Yeah, my Lord, it's 4:30. With my Lord's permission, may I begin the proceedings?
Okay. Sorry, you are supposed to begin.
Yes, I'll start the proceedings.
The advocate in us never dies. That's the problem. Okay, sorry.
Please, I, Chanchal K. Singla, Honorary Secretary, Punjab and Haryana High Court Bar Association, welcome you all for the second workshop on the essentials of drafting and presentation. The pleadings in a case define the issue to be adjudicated in action. Drafting may be defined as synthesis of law and facts in language form. The essence of drafting is therefore crystallization and expressions in definite form of legal rights, privilege function, duties, or status. The Punjab and Haryana High Court Bar Association, under the able leadership of worthy President Shri G.B.S. Dillon, has undertaken various steps for the upliftment of legal community at large and also restoring the glory of this glorious institution. The setting up of High Court Lawyers Academy is one such important step, which would prove to be a milestone in the history of this great institution, as no lawyers association or council or any government authority has done so in the past. The lawyers community would be able to upgrade, polish, and hone its skills to match the best in the world in these times of globalization by utilizing the programs of this academy. Now I request worthy President Shri G.B.S. Dhillon to welcome you all on behalf of Punjab and Haryana High Court Bar Association. Worthy President Shri Dhillon.
I, on behalf of the Punjab and Haryana High Court Bar Association, welcome Honorable Mr. Justice Vikas Bell, who has been kind enough to accept the request of the Bar Association to address today's workshop on essentials of drafting and presentation to enlighten and guide the members of the legal fraternity on the various aspects of drafting and presentation. Justice Bell has been a leading lawyer with exceptional qualities of hard work and dedication and in-depth knowledge of law before being elevated to the bench. He had to his kitty various landmark judgments which we people feel privileged while citing those judgments before the honorable courts. I also welcome our esteemed legal luminary, Shri Anupam Gupta, Senior Advocate, who has graciously accepted to be today's guest. Mr. Gupta needs no introduction, as he is an inspiration to everyone and is an outstanding legal brain. I also welcome today's esteemed guest, Dr. Monica Sharma, Principal Riyadh College of Law, and all the participants of today's workshop, which is one of a kind initiative taken by Punjab Haryana High Court Bar Association by setting up country's first High Court Lawyers Academy, which has been set up to enhance the skills of the budding lawyers. And at the same time, the legal fraternity as a whole will also benefit with the initiatives of the High Court Lawyers Academy by producing better equipped lawyers to our institution. High Court Lawyers Academy works on the motto of maxim sic parvis magna, which means greatness is achieved from a small beginning. So this workshop is an initiative which is a part of this small beginning. With these words, I may now request our Honorary Secretary to carry forward today's workshop. Thanks.
It has been observed that legal profession, being a constantly evolving profession, needs persistent upgradation of skills, knowledge, tools, and technology, apart from exposure to emerging legal fields. The judicial officers are regularly trained through judicial academies to upgrade and polish their skills. However, there is no such forum, mechanism, or training program for lawyers community. The law colleges have their limitations in practical aspects of law. In the last few years, it has been observed that many new laws and procedures have been enacted, which have emerged as parallel fields of law to the traditional litigation. In order to invest in human capital and make our honorable members and other willing legal professionals equipped with the latest upgraded skills, the Punjab and Haryana High Court Bar Association, Chandigarh, had decided to set up India's first High Court Lawyers Academy, which shall be holding various training programs for the benefit of the existing and emerging legal professionals. The second such legal workshop on essentials of drafting and presentation is being conducted today by Honorable Mr. Justice Vikas Behal. All the participants are requested to post their questions in the message box. The selected persons having the most relevant question would be allowed to ask questions directly to the Honorable Judge. No participant would unmute himself, herself without being specifically asked to do so. The participants who wish to ask questions to the Honorable Speaker are requested to raise their hands by using the feature given in the Zoom application. The participation certificates would be issued to all the participants who register themselves from the link now being shared in the Zoom chat box. I request my team to share the link.
The link
has been link has been shared now. All are requested to register themselves on the link provided. Honorable Justice Vikas Behal was born in the family of lawyers. His father, late Shri Amrit Lal Behal, was a senior advocate who practiced for several years in the Honorable Punjab and Haryana High Court, Chandigarh. His grandfather, late Shri Balraj Behal, also practiced for several decades in the Honorable Punjab and Haryana High Court. Justice Behal was enrolled on 22nd of March 1999 as member of the Bar Council of Punjab and Haryana. During this period at the bar, he practiced in various fields of law, such as civil, revenue, rent, criminal, constitution, arbitration, including international arbitration, service law, company law. He was all on the panel of lawyers to conduct cases on behalf of Honorable Punjab and Haryana High Court and conducted several cases on its behalf, that too pro bono. He was also on the panel of Union Territory Chandigarh Administration. He was designated as senior advocate on 29th of January 2014. He was elevated as additional judge of Punjab and Haryana High Court on 25th of May, 2021. I now request Honorable Justice Vikas Behal to conduct the workshop on essentials of drafting and presentation. Honorable Justice Behal.
Over to Justice.
My Lord, I think my Lord is still muted.
Check. My Lord is still muted. Please check.
Am I audible now?
Now my Lord is audible.
Okay.
Firstly, I must thank Mr. Dillon and Mr. Singla for such kind words. And I also thank all the members of the bar and all my friends who are here for this present webinar. And a special thanks to Mr. Gupta and Monica ma'am for being our guests. Today, from whatever experience I have had, I wanted to share certain things with respect to this topic, which I feel is very, very pertinent. And in fact, I can be honest to everybody that whenever I get the opportunity, this is the one topic that I really want to elaborate. I want to really share my experience with everybody, because as far as drafting and presentation is concerned, these are the two most material aspects, I think, in a lawyer's life, especially when the lawyer is in the beginning of his career, to really shape up as to what ultimately he might and he would achieve. Now, to start from the start, I would just firstly, in a very simple manner, try to explain and try to mention it to everybody that, especially for people, those who are, you know, just joined the profession or who are very young in the profession, what we were told always, and what I would like to now tell my younger colleagues, is that wherever a client comes or a case comes to any of my younger colleagues, the first thing that the three things that they need to know, really, which we were told, is what is the limitation in a particular case. Second, as to where does the case lie. And third, what is the court fee of a case? So, my younger colleagues, whenever, I mean, if we know that there are certain kind of matters which are filed in the High Court, there would be something on the civil side, maybe an RSA, regular second appeal. There would be on the criminal side, a criminal appeal. There would be a writ jurisdiction. There would be petitions under Section 482 and various other orders, various other proceedings arising from interim orders, etc. So as a young colleague, I would only say that these three things are very mandatory for you even to interact with a client in the very beginning. So whenever a client would come to you, or whenever a client is recommended to you, the first thing that you need to know is whether the case that he wishes to file, whether that would lie in the High Court or would it not be maintainable in the High Court. Because in case you're not able to really know that fact, then it would end up being an embarrassing position if maybe that one accepts the brief and ultimately one realizes that the petition is not even maintainable, assuming it's a first appeal arising from a civil court's order that has to go to the district court. So it's only a second appeal which would come to the High Court. Similarly, if some kind of an order is passed by some authority, maybe the deputy commissioner or the commissioner, there are appellate authorities and jurisdictions. So one must be very sure about these two aspects, the aspect of whether the petition is maintainable in the High Court or not. The second and very important aspect would be that what would be the limitation of a particular kind of a case which is to be filed in the High Court. Because in your first interaction with the client, possibly that is the first thing that, that is the second thing you need to know, so that you can assess how much time you would have in trying to get the record, in trying to make out the case, and in trying to really file the case. And as we have seen practically, the client would also want that kind of a knowledge on your behalf on the first go only. Because whenever he would come, possibly he would be in a hurry, possibly he would want to know whether he's lost on time, etc. So that is the second thing you need to know. The third thing regarding court fee, I always also insist and request my friends to just have a vague idea as to whether writ petitions are filed, what kind of a stamp is required, whenever an appeal is filed, how much is the court fee? Because there is one instance which always comes to my mind. My Chacha Ji was also a lawyer in the Punjab Haryana High Court, initially when he started with my grandfather and with my father. So at that time, the fee was very minimal. I mean, somebody would get 1,000 rupees would be an outstanding fee for a particular case. And even senior advocates used to charge that much. So it happened with him once that my father and my grandfather were not available. So there is a client who came and he engaged my Chacha after being impressed with the fact that he knew certain basic things about the matter. So he accepted the matter. And at that time, the fee that was settled was rupees 1,000. So my Chacha was so excited that, you know, it's a wonderful thing and it's going to be a good month for him. He's going to utilize, he's going to have fun, etc. Once he goes through the matter and he does the matter. So he accepted the matter. He took 1,000 rupees, thinking that whatever little bit expense is there, he would meet out of that 1,000 rupees. So the moment the client went back and the moment everything was to be done, when the case was to be filed, he realized that the, in fact, the court fee in that is more than rupees 1,000. So, and then to get back to the client to be asking at his age would have been a big embarrassment for him. And this is what he shared with me, that he actually had to pay from his own pocket in order to get the case rolling. So what I say is that these three things, if you know, at least at, even as a young lawyer, you'll be able to accept a brief. As far as law is concerned, as far as how to go about, maybe subsequently you're able to work on it and process it and then ultimately be able to present the case. So this is the first part. The second part, and a very important part, would now be on the aspect of drafting. Now, fortunately for me, I was designated as senior advocate. Some of my younger colleagues who are such brilliant colleagues, they came and engaged me in matters. So I had the opportunity of seeing drafting of a large number of my younger colleagues. And now as a judge for the last 2.5 months, I have seen a lot of petitions coming up on the criminal side, on the tax side, and the rosters that I've been able to, I've been given by the Honorable Chief Justice. So in that, I found that some youngsters were really outstanding. And there were some youngsters who needed to a little bit work more towards a proper way of drafting. Now, what I can share from my experience is that primarily I would, as far as the drafting aspect is concerned, primarily I would say the kind of cases that would come to the High Court for you to draft and you to pursue it would primarily be, could be divided into two kind of petitions. One would be an appeal or a revision, an appeal, etc., arising out of the proceedings which have taken place from the lower courts. For example, a regular second appeal would be an appeal arising from a proceeding. A civil revision would be a petition which would be arising from a proceeding. It would not be an original proceeding, original petition. And like similarly, a criminal revision or a criminal appeal and from 138 proceedings, etc. These would all, in my understanding, be proceedings and also revenue. In a writ in the arising from revenue proceedings from collectors, commissioners, and then the financial commissioners. So this kind of proceedings, I would bracket them in one situation. I would bracket them together. And I would say that all these would emanate from proceeding where there already something has happened in the courts below. The other obviously is original proceedings. That would be writ petition. That would be maybe a petition under section for a direction, maybe a protection of life and liberty as we now say it, and some similar petitions. Now I would first like to dwell on the fact as to how I would advise my younger colleagues to follow up matters or to draft matters in which there it is emanating from the proceedings coming from the courts below. The first and foremost thing that we all need to now see is that whenever such a matter comes, please do insist from the client that he should get the record, the entire record of that proceeding to you. Assuming it's an appeal, please request the clients or the counsels who are coming along with the clients to get a complete copy from the first page to the last page of the trial court proceeding, so as to call. I mean, in rent court, there will be rent controller proceeding. In a RSA, it will be trial court proceeding, even in a revision. Once you, and insist on that, because one does not know that which page of the record would ultimately help you in making out a star argument, which would help you in winning the matter. So once you are able to get the record, and I can tell you at a younger, when you are young in life, when you possibly can't dictate terms to the clients and the lawyers, there would be a lot of people coming up and saying that, sorry, brother, we can't get the entire record. This lawyer's record is enough. Or this record, it is a little expensive. It takes around 2,000 rupees to get a photostat copy of the entire record. I would suggest and request to my friends, as I did as a young lawyer, I would say that if you're paying me 5,000 rupees, please deduct that 2,000 rupees, but please give me the entire record. Because the catch in those things is sometimes you take the lawyer's record and make a case on the basis of a lawyer's record. There will be so many situations, which I can just enumerate also, that there will be certain applications which would be in a lawyer's record, which may not be the correct, which may have never been filed. It happened with one of our colleagues, lawyers. There was an application under Order 41, Rule 27, which had been drafted by a lawyer but not filed in the case. So it was not a part of the record. So on the basis of that application and thinking that that application has not been decided without the seeing the full record that that lawyer had filed, because I happened to be sitting at the time when that matter was taken up, that lawyer had filed the case by stating that since the application under order 41 rule 27 has not been decided, therefore on the basis of various judgments the matter should be remanded back. So on the basis of that, probably notice of motion was issued and interim order was granted. But when the matter came up for final arguments, it was pointed out that that application was never filed, and therefore it was only plausible in the brief of the advocate, and ultimately because of the stay that had been in a way issued or obtained, costs were imposed. So this is one. I would say that please insist on the record of the courts below to be given to you, even if it amounts to some kind of a deduction from your fee, etc. Because what happens is, once we see the entire record of the case, and once we are able to then draft up and then end up drafting, you would see that the difference in the points that you would taken out, would you be able to take out from the entire record, would be much, much more than the points that you'd be able to take out without seeing the record or seeing half of the record. Two examples more I can give to my friends, and I would really want to request everybody to see the record because it has helped me in my life, even at a time when I did not know much of law. The two examples I wanted to give was one example of a case which was filed way back in the 1970s. It was a case which was filed on a suit for recovery of money, which was filed by A against B. And that suit for recovery, during the course of the suit for recovery, was ultimately decreed. During the pendency of that suit, there was a sale made by the person who was the defendant, the B, in favor of a third party. The third party was a bona fide purchaser. They had no idea about the suit pending. And since the suit was not with respect to any property, so therefore the question of list pendants also would not have arisen. So that poor man who had bought that property without knowing about the suit for recovery, which in a way is irrelevant also for the fact that I'm stating till now, paid the entire money, got the property. Ultimately, what happens is, after the suit is decreed against B who had sold the property, execution is filed, and in execution he gets a notice saying that, sorry, sir, this property was attached. It is an attached property in a suit for recovery. And because it is attached, you have purchased the property, so the decree has to be met with. So as far as the decree is concerned, it will be executed against the property. Whatever balance would be left, you can take it out, etc. So he was very unhappy, naturally. He was shocked. So he files objections. The objections are dismissed. The appeal therefrom is dismissed. He comes to the High Court in ESA. That ESA is also dismissed. He goes to the Supreme Court, because it's a very valuable property. The Supreme Court SLP is dismissed. The second round starts. The execution moves forward. Now, this time the objections are filed by his son. They wanted to delay the execution. They wanted to delay the, because they were in possession of the property. Same objections filed, dismissed, appeal dismissed, High Court dismissed with cost. And Supreme Court, the top lawyers were engaged, dismissed. The matter moves forward. Then the third set of objections are filed by the daughter of this man who had purchased the property. Appeal dismissed, objections dismissed, the matter comes to the High Court. These people, for some reason, they came to engage me. I took a promise from them that this matter, I can't do it in the urgent. And I said that this is probably the worst matter that I've got. And in case I feel that there's nothing in it, maybe I don't even argue. And I'll just stand up and say that there's nothing to argue. But for some reason, somebody had faith in me and they said that, no, you please carry on with this matter. Please go ahead with this matter. So I took up the matter and I even took it in writing from the client that in case I stand up and I don't even argue on a particular situation, you will be fine with it. So they're all fine. So I took up the matter. We had to file it in the ordinary course because such a matter, obviously, one doesn't see any light in it. So as we started preparing the matter, In the matter, what had happened is that I asked for the record of the original suit. I told my colleagues were there. They are very efficient. So they said that please give us the record of the original suit in which the attachment had taken place. All the lawyers refused because it was a 1970-75 case. So they kept calling us back, the trial court lawyers, all my brothers. They said, sir, why are you putting so much? Once we know there's nothing in the case, the client has been fair enough. He has just said that you file it in the ordinary. The matter will never be taken up and whatever, we will take dates in the executing court. But since we had been entrusted with the matter, so we thought that we must see the entire record. God knows what will come out of the record. So after much insistence, because it was a very old record, and that first record, to cut it short, the first record was given to us after a month and a half. When the first record was given to us, Mr. Gupta is now here also. Sir, it is the most surprising thing that has happened in my career. There was no attachment. There was no attachment of property. What had happened is that the order of attachment which everybody was referring to was an order which said it is for attachment for so-and-so date. And on that date, the judge was on leave. It was never attached. Now, nobody ever took up that point in the objections because everybody kept looking at the execution. Everybody kept looking at the objections. Everybody kept looking at the record of the execution. Nobody looked at the record of the original suit as to whether there was any attachment. Nobody could even, nobody could have visualized that. The moment we found that, we were a little nervous. I asked them to get the certified copy of all the Zemini orders. We got the certified copies. I told my friends that we will file it in the urgent. The matter was filed in the urgent. And at that time, we had one of the most honorable intelligent judges who was there. So I filed it because there was res judicata. Maybe there was res judicata still against me. So I got up and the honorable judge said, Mr. Behl, if you speak one word, I will impose a very heavy cost. Because possibly you would have read the order, but not known that what is the whole record. And I just said one line in a minute. I said, my lord, there is no attachment. And then he saw me. He looked at me. He was very surprised. So he said, what do you mean? You have lost twice up to Supreme Court. How is the daughter coming up? I said, this is what it is. There's no attachment. This is a mistake we have made. We've never raised that objection anywhere. But I have got the certified copy of the entire Zemini. And we got stay in that. So it's not just the matter of what relief you get. So what happened? Ultimately, do I say that I'm a great lawyer or my colleagues are great lawyers that they're able to, you know, have a law, illegal point? Nothing, no legal point. If one had just read the record, we just saw it that my colleague just saw it that there is no attachment. So on the basis of the record, a matter, and I can't tell you who all appeared in the Supreme Court. The top lawyers of the country appeared in the Supreme Court. But what can the lawyers also do when the entire record is not shown to them? It's my younger colleagues who will read the record. It's my younger colleagues who will be able to take out a point from that record while assisting the senior advocates who actually make or break a case. There will be very, very few lawyers as a senior advocate like Mr. Gupta who would see every word and every line of every case. But by and large, as we've seen, it is the younger colleagues who make the case, actually do make the case. The law, almost everybody knows, but it is these facts which we need to feed to the court in order to win matters. And sir, one more example. I'm sorry if I'm little dwelling on this, but I really wanted to insist to all my younger colleagues that you must get the record. There's another case. There was a very, very senior person in a high court. It was his relative's case. And his son came to me. What had happened is, sir, this is a criminal matter now for some of my criminal some of my friends who do a lot of criminal work. Now, in that matter, a Jama Bandi was taken by the client. On the Jama Bandi, he had put a piece of paper to hide the mutation. And in the civil proceedings, he had put that Jama Bandi on record. So after putting the Jama Bandi on record, it was a fabrication because he had tried to hide that mutation part. So what happened is that the honorable judge who was hearing the case in the civil side got very angry, very unhappy with the client and the lawyer who was appearing. So he said, I'm going to take action. I'm going to issue notice in a criminal complaint. I'm going to make it a criminal complaint. He told the lawyer, just give me a complaint. I will issue summoning for having forged the documents. Now, whatever may be the legal aspect of 340, etc. So he passes an order a complaint is filed by that lawyer on the other side that there's fabrication of record, and he passes a summoning order, summoning these persons who had fabricated. And he had seen the Jama Mandi with his own hand. He had seen the Jama Mandi with his own eyes. And that Jama Mandi, which is a forged Jama Mandi, was a part of the civil court record. So as they came to us, and since there was somebody who was very dear, so I took up the matter. We followed up the matter. So my younger friend came. He said, please give me the record of the criminal case, summoning, and all the preliminary evidence, if any. And please get it, the entire record from page one to the last page, including the power of attorney. So he said, sir, it's very difficult because till the time you don't appear in a summoning matter, it's very difficult to get the record, but we'll try to get the photostat copy. Let us see. So after a lot of pushing and not, and he would say no, and ultimately we pushed him and we got that record, sir. And my friends. And he got that record. Sir, it was surprising that in that record, the Jama Mandi was not placed. The Jama Mandi was not placed in the record of the criminal case. So an honorable judge had issued summoning order without there being a Jama Mandi on the record, which is stated to be forged. So with this plea, we made the whole case. We presented it before the honorable court. There's no misstatement. So if somebody were to ask me that your man has done it, I would have said yes. But what I argued before the court on the basis of the record that we got is that here is a summoning order which has been passed on the basis of a Jama Mandi, which is not forming a part of the criminal record, the trial. You would not believe that the honorable judge called for the record. He said, Mr. Behl, in case your argument is not correct, I will impose cost. And in case your argument is correct, then we'll take administrative action against the judge who issued the summoning order. The record was called. I had the photostat. I had the complete copy. I said, no, I've seen from page 1 to page 27. The record was called. Notice of motion. Stay operation was the order. And comments of the judge was called for. So what I'm telling to my younger colleagues, and instances would be so many. In civil proceedings, we have seen instances would be one after the other. Sometimes in a matter. Now, one last example before I, dwell on the other aspects of drafting and presentation. Is that from the record now, we all know of this law now very well, that if an application is filed under Order 41 to 27 and it is not decided, then it's a ground for remand. There are several Supreme Court judgments. There are several judgments of the High Court. Now, when did this point first come up? I remember probably there was one judgment of Justice V.M. Jain, which was there on the point in the beginning. So there was a case. We looked up everything. There was no point to our understanding. The judgments were perfect. They were all brilliant and brilliantly written, nothing in the matter. But we called for the appellate court record. In that, the application was filed. Reply was there, but there was no decision on that application. All that was a completely irrelevant application for additional evidence. And we had that judgment in our hand. So how did that, now we filed that case. There was a very, very senior counsel on the other side on caveat. And I still remember when I said this point, the honorable judge looked up and he just laughed at us. And then when I showed the judgment, the honorable judge was very kind. He put it to the caveater and he said, senior counsel, this is the judgment they have cited. And this is the point that they are raising. So I still remember there was a smile from the other side. And the smile was that this is a completely relevant point. How is it even, substantial justice has been done. Both the courts are against them. The honorable judge, notice of motion was issued, stay was granted, and ultimately the matter was remanded back. All these and several more points, I can tell you, would come up, and I can share this with you, that my first 10 years of my practice, I did not know, 15 years rather of my practice, I did not know much law. All the matters that I had won or I was successful in was only on account of a careful reading of the record, the evidence, which was already there. Luckily for us, the honorable judges would know the law. Luckily for us, our senior colleagues are there to help us, assist us, carry us forward. But the facts of a case, the record of a case, is the most important thing that needs to be known. And one more thing, brothers. The examples are one after the other, but I want to share another one. In one of the cases, what had happened is, a court had recorded a finding that for proving a will, we all know that at least one attesting witness is required to be examined if he is living and is within the bounds of the country, etc. So in one of the cases, what had happened is that none of the witnesses were examined, and therefore our registered will was rejected. Now, so everybody came up and said that this is a dead case. It's only an equity, maybe that somebody might interfere because there's a will in our favor. But otherwise, the mandatory provisions of 63, 68, etc. have not been met. So we can't carry the case forward. In any case, once the record was seen, to cut it short, now we got the record after much insistence. Every time we've been able to get the record after much insistence, because the first reaction is the lawyer's record is enough. We saw the Zimini orders. As per the Zimini orders, one of the testing witnesses had been called. Rather, both the testing witnesses had been called. They had appeared in the court, both of them. And on that day, there was a recorded that it was time is over. Both of them are there. They are bound down for the next day. One day the judge did not come. And thereafter, one of them died. And one of them went abroad. So that Zimini order ultimately completely proved what we were. And it was not mentioned in either of the two judgments. It was not there with the brief of the advocate. And in fact, they had come and said that it's a registered. We'll just try to argue on that. So these small, small points, which you will get from a careful reading of the record, you will possibly not be able to make out without that record being there. Howsoever intelligent a lawyer you may be, howsoever knowledge of law you may be having. So my first request to all my friends is, my younger colleagues, is that you must insist on the record and don't file a case till the time you have seen the entire record. Once you see the entire record, you will have the confidence of being able to answer all the queries of the court. You will have the confidence of rebutting whatever the other counsel is arguing, and you will be able to take it forward. Now, as far as the first, now I wanted to then share something with respect to drafting. Now, as I said, that there were two different kind of matters that you need to file. The first matters would be the matters which emanate from the proceeding which are in the lower court, etc. Brothers, on that, what I have learned from all stalwarts and whatever little bit I can tell you would be that please hold a piece of paper, two pieces of paper like this. This is what I have done in my entire life. Hold a piece of paper, hold another piece of paper. Let's assume that we are drafting an RSC. Possibly a lot of people find it to be one of the toughest things to argue, etc. So let me just go start from an RSC only. Please hold two pages and please start from the judgment of the appellate court. And I'm saying this to a person who's just a beginner, just a novice. And let us assume that the beginner does not know anything of civil law, as I never knew in the beginning. Read every line of that judgment of the appellate court. Just write down the name on the top of your note. Read every word. The first paragraph would always tell you that what is the case of the plaintiff. After you have read the case of the plaintiff, sit back for 2 minutes. Think about it. Whichever language you understand, whether it is Hindi or it is Punjabi or it is English, digest the fact as to what is the case of the plaintiff. Assuming his case is that there is an agreement to sell, and the agreement to sell, he came on a particular date, and that date the other person did not come. So understand that. Spend 2 minutes after you've read the first part of the appellate court judgment. Then go to the next part, which would be the case of the defendant. After reading that part of the case of the defendant, understand it, sit back for 2 minutes. So then you are sure as to what is the case of the plaintiff and what is the case of the defendant. You'll find the issues coming up, and thereafter you will be the arguments raised by the counsel for the appellate. There will be a small paragraph saying why in the trial court you have lost. And then would be the argument of the appellant. Then would be the argument of the respondent. And then would be the finding. Now, brothers, as you would read, and my sisters, as you would read that, just divide the page into two parts. This is what I used to do. As you are reading and as you are coming to the finding, now the finding of a case has to be right here. You have to be 200% sure as to on what two or three grounds the appellate court has held against you or has rejected your argument. The difficulty that we face is sometimes in our mind, the argument of the other side overlaps with the finding of the court. Forget about the, because in order to succeed in such a matter, which arises from the proceedings in the lower court, the honorable judge ultimately will come back to tell you or ask you, please tell me how the finding is bad. So it is just like a doctor who sees the x-ray. So the finding of which is normally in the last 4 or 5 pages of every impugn order is the starting point of solving any matter or taking it forward. So the finding of the case, and what we invariably used to do is, supposing we have lost on 3 points. So please make out a point limitation. Supposing you lost on limitation, just write down limitation as a heading. If you have lost out on the point not ready and willing, please write down not ready and willing. If you have lost on a third point, please make those 3 points on the latter half of the, on the bottom half of your page. So you know that these 3 points which have been held against me in the proceedings, I need to resolve by seeing the entire record. So this is what you will do. And alongside with that, why did I see, please keep a second page. Keep a second page for the reason that the appellant lawyer would have argued, because the trial court also invariably, the decision would have been on those 3-4 grounds only. The appellate court lawyer would have argued and left it to some judgments. So what you can do is, in the second page, at that same time, as you're reading the appellate court judgment, please jot down the judgments on a particular point. Assuming on limitation, just write down limitation there also. There are 4 judgments which have been cited by the appellant lawyer. Please write F favor, write down those 4 judgments in the second page. And similarly, the judgments which are against you on that point, please give the heading and write down those 4-5 judgments which have been cited by the court or by the counsel for the other side as the judgments against. So, and after reading, you know these 3 points are against me. These are the findings against me. These are the judgments which are in my favor cited, which are against me cited. After you finish with that, if something else comes in your mind that, okay, no, I know this limitation, or I know this can't be the point, so, or the suit was not maintainable. If you have some knowledge of your, maybe a thought process is also there, that no, I think this point I can raise, that the suit is not maintainable. So just write down that as a 4th point. So apart from the finding that you need to meet as an appellant, you need to, if there's something coming in your mind, maybe you don't know any law of that. Maybe you have never come across a judgment. Out of your common sense and out of your understanding, if you're able to jot down a 4th point, please jot down a 4th or a 5th point also. Now, once you're done with this, my request is now start seeing the record. So while you're seeing the record, the finding is always rotating in your mind. You know that, okay, there's a finding which says that DW1 has admitted that I was not ready and willing. So that is the argument, that is the finding which you need to break. As you start reading the plaint, assuming a limitation finding is against you and you know that finding inside out, when you start reading the plaint, there is a paragraph 6 which talks about that I had gone to him yesterday and yesterday he had refused. So you feel that paragraph will help you in trying to bring out a point of limitation. Under that point of limitation, just write down paragraph 6. Just take down and write down paragraph 6 of the plaint. And likewise, in the other, under the other headings, if you find something from the plaint, since you know the 3 points which are against you, write down paragraph 2, I have averred ready and willingness here. I have averred limitation here. Then go to the written statement. See from the written statement, what is the answer to those paragraphs? Assuming in paragraph 6, by mistake, the respondent says matter of record. Oh, that's a point made straight away. Assuming in ready and willingness, he says that no, the money was there, but this was not there. So something is there, you will immediately go and say paragraph 6 of the written statement, paragraph 2 of the. So under each heading, you will keep on filling up the points as you keep seeing the record. Once you're through with the pleadings, once then you, I mean, this is what slowly, slowly, as you gain a little bit of experience, come to the cross-examination, come to the evidence of the other side. If you are the defendant, please see the evidence of the plaintiff first. If you are the plaintiff, please see the evidence of the defendant first. And out of the defendant witnesses also, assuming there are 10 of them, the best witness would always be the defendant himself, his cross-examination, or the plaintiff himself. So first, it's better to read the cross-examination of the person who is the opposite party in that case. Because whatever would be the trial court lawyer's magic, that would all be in the cross-examination. See every word, and the moment you find out some line in the cross-examination saying that although, I didn't have the money, something like that, just mark it. And at the same moment, just mark it in the heading of ready and willingness also. So once you have seen this entire evidence, then that evidence part would be over. If there's something very stark, majorly which has come out, that's fine. Then you go to the documents. Or in some matters, maybe you need to see the documents first. First come to your own documents. Then in case you're able to see that, I'm only giving an example of a specific performance agreement suit, which is a slightly easier kind of a suit. You have seen your legal notice. Okay. You take down legal notice. No reply. This is the date. What date did you file the suit? So bring it all under ready and willingness. So you are now from the entire record, taking out points so as to feed it to the judge under that point to show that how that finding is perverse or wrong or a contrary to record or illegal. Now, once you have seen that, assuming you don't get anything much, there is a younger colleague in my office, and I'm not sure whether she's here or not. She had that nag of then going into the last part, which is the toughest part, of seeing the examination in chief of the witness, of our witnesses, and seeing as to what has been put to that in that examination in chief, in the cross-examination. There are several judgments we have of our High Court, starting from 77, etc., which say that if in the examination in chief something is said, and that is not rebutted in the cross-examination, then it's an admission. So sometimes, you know, we have evidence in vernacular. So you need to have a very high level of concentration to be able to see the chief. In the chief, 7-8 issues, maybe somebody would have said, yes, I am ready and willing always. And imagine the lawyer did not put a question or a suggestion to that witness that you were ready and willing or you are not ready and willing. That would be a point again in your favor. So once you're able to bring up all these points, just put it on those points in that heading. Now, once you have done all that, it would depend. If you are short on time, you are ready to draft. But if you have enough time with you and you're a young lawyer, and in this COVID time, we see that, you know, we have sufficient time so that we can really prepare a matter well, then start looking at the judgments which are there, cited by the other counsel, cited by the counsel for the respondent, in the judgment which have been cited by you. Now, this is a very situation. Let me just first, because this also I really want to dwell in. And with no offense meant to my younger colleagues, or even people, you know, stalwarts in Delhi, etc. The difficulty that we are finding is that the judgments which are being cited are either completely relevant or are in fact against the person who's citing it. Because what we need to see is that we have to relate back a judgment, the finding or the law that has been laid on in a judgment, back to the facts of that case, as to whether the facts of that case, when compared to the facts of our case, would justify citing the judgment or not, which I'll come to a little later. So you go through those judgments. Every judgment, whatever is cited in your favor, see, assess, is it in your favor or not in comparison to the facts of your case? If it is, please mark it, keep it on one side. Whatever is been cited against you, just scroll through the whole judgment. Whatever factual issue you can get, which is a distinguishing factor in a judgment, please mark that as one, please mark that as two, please mark that as three. So that you, whenever the honorable judge will ask you as to what do you say about the judgment which have been cited against you, you'll be able to tell the judge, 1, 2, 3, 4, these are the points of distinction in this case, etc., etc. But before I come to the presentation part and the legal part, let me finish with the drafting part. Now, once you have seen the entire record, then your drafting part becomes very, very easy. Why does it become so easy? Is that in an RSA, now I may tell you, it's not original proceedings, please don't write anything from your own side. Please don't give your own version. Just don't say what is said in the plain. Don't say anything. You only have to meet the 4 or 5 grounds which are against you and I would say place on record all the documents that you need to refer to a particular honorable judge. Now, assuming if I have called out those points while I was reading the whole file, if I were to say that my first ground would be, apart from the judgment being bad, rather the third ground would be that the finding of the court below on the ground of issue number three, ready and willingness, is perverse and illegal. Just leave it open. Leave it as broad as you can in your favor. And then say, for the set of the evidence of DW1 has been misconstrued and misapplied. Annex the evidence. The pleading has been misconstrued. Annex it. So whatever you feel, nowadays we do annex the pleading first and then come to the evidence. Whatever you feel was the highest point in that, under that point, mention about that the first, just say perverse, misconstrued. So that you have taken a point, just annex all the documents which you have found, the entire evidence which you have found to be in your favor along with the appeal. There would be a lot of suggestion, brothers, I can tell you this. If you tell an honorable judge, my lord, the court has held that he's a Sikh, but actually he's a Hindu, please see the evidence. There could be a reaction that this is a finding of fact, I am not going to see it. Because by the time you will take out your evidence, by the time you will give it to the judge, possibly the judge would react, think of another question, or maybe say it's a finding of fact and that's the end of it. But in case you annex everything with your case, you can just stand up and say, please see this. And I would say every judge who has the entire file would at least grant you those 3-4 minutes. Please make him read that piece of evidence and tell him that line so-and-so, page so-and-so, this particular person says he's a Hindu gentleman. Then read the next evidence. Then read your reply. Then read whatever you want to show to come to ultimately the conclusion that the finding is perverse. And then if you make the judge read that finding, I can tell you, my brothers, there is a 99% chance that there will be a notice of motion in your favor. You will be able to succeed for your client. And because whenever the judge is able to see the whole evidence in front of him, the judge is able to see that whole thing. So my whatever little bit I have learned from my life, it would be a request that please make a composite case. Don't make a case trying to avoid annexing those documents. If they are in vernacular, do translate them. Because now what will happen? A younger colleague could always feel that somebody has paid such a less fee, especially in these tough times. Then in case so much of money is spent on translations, on, you know, ultimately the matter being put across, my brothers, just don't worry. We have seen Mr. Gupta, we have seen people who are stalwarts, who have grown up in life. The kind of fee that you will be offered will be completely different level. It's just that you need to start right like that in the young of your career. What will happen? Initially, people will be a little unhappy with you because you're delaying matters. But by and by, the lawyer who's referring the matter to you would understand that this man studies everything. The lawyer, the honorable judge before whom the case is listed, and you have even put in one argument, one appearance, would know that this boy is always prepared. So third, the client who's there, the client would understand, because the clients have become very intelligent. They see so many people reading cases in a very, very casual manner. So the moment they find that you are the one who reads everything, I can tell you, brothers, by and by, they will flock towards you. And so once you read that thoroughly, so there will be 4 or 5 advantages you will gain on the first day itself, or in that process itself. So you will possibly win over a heart and at least the judge's recognition. Maybe you lose the matter by the end of it. One. Secondly, the client will see you preparing the entire, seeing the entire record. He would have a lot of faith in you. Third, all the queries of the judge, you'll be able to meet because you have the entire record in front of you. You read the entire record. Any argument from the other side, you will never need to misstate. You will never need to say something which you are not sure of. You will not need to seek an adjournment to be able to answer a judge on a particular factual aspect. Otherwise, what happens is if we go half-baked in a matter, we have seen so many times, all that we get from the court is either a dismissal or an adjournment. Because if we have a point, then we don't have the evidence, or we have to place on record that evidence. So you will save yourself of 3-4 dates, which you will have to repeatedly seek if you have not made a wholesome case. So as far as these cases coming from the record are concerned, whether it's a revenue writ petition coming up or it's even a criminal revision in a 138, please see the whole record, because the point that you're going to raise would depend upon the entire record. Don't make the points first and then see the record. And ultimately, my brothers, you will have to spend time. So whether you spend it at the time of final arguments or you spend it, my advice to you, do it on the first day. Why I say do it on the first day? If you will spend 2-3 days, the client, if he's ready to pay you 5,000, he will also pay you 7. Because he will say that the effort that is going into the case is a lot more than possibly the other lawyers would. Second, once you are fully prepared on the first day, you will also get to learn some new points which will help you in, you know, in some other matters which are similar matters. Third, when you're appearing on the first day, you're fully prepared. Maybe a judge issues notice on the first point and is convinced about it, but maybe the judge gets stuck on the first day. So if you think that, oh, for notice of motion, this is good enough, but I'll prepare the other 4 points, they're all gone, because by that time the case will be dismissed. So there will be every advantage of preparing a matter to the final, as if you have to finally argue the matter on the first day. That client will stay with you. You have got due fee, so you will be able to put in the best. And when the matter comes up for final argument, that original note that you have made, the original marking that you have done, that will all stay with you. So this is as far as the appeals part are concerned. Please see the entire record. Just write down the points. You don't need to repeat the whole story. You just need to mention those points and the question of law, etc., that is to be framed. And also, so in all proceedings which emanate from the lower court proceedings. In original proceedings, obviously, it's a completely different ballgame. In original proceedings, as I said, that the first thing that you need to know really is whether such a writ is maintainable, whether such a petition, which the whether whatever the grievance of the client is, whether that you can even, you know, institute anything in the High Court, or is it a matter of the courts below, or is it a matter to be filed in some other forum? Or so for all those aspects, some my younger colleagues who will not be very, very sure about as to what is to be done, what we used to do is, whenever any such a thing would come up, if a client is giving you 20 documents, please hold those 20 documents. Please put those 20 documents in seriatim. The one which is earlier point of time, please put that at the first. Put the other 10 after that. And then just start reading them. Once you start reading them, the entire story of what he is wanting to say would possibly come before you. If there is some response which has been given by the authorities to the petitioner, that would possibly be the highest point, because that would be the point which would be rejecting his claim. And that is what you need to really challenge, solve out, and institute a petition about, etc. Now, in those kind of cases, once you have been able to, while you're reading those letters which they have been given to you by the client, note the date of every letter. Assuming in a letter that you have in your possession, there is a reference of another letter which the client does not have, ask him to get that letter. That would give you also time to, you know, maybe take advice, maybe think that whether there's such a petition would be. So try to complete the record. As I would say, in the first instance, you should always do one thing. Try to complete the entire record of the case and then move forward. So in a writ petition, what you do is possibly see all the documents in seriatim. There would be some document which would be referred in a particular document which would not be with the client. Ask him to get that so that the entire chain is with you. Now, once that is with you, obviously you need to know whether such a petition can be filed in the High Court or not. Now, that obviously will come something with experience. And once you feel that, yes, there is something that can be filed in the court, then the pleading has to be very different. The pleading has to be very, whatever you would say that in the pleading would be the only point which would be considered by the Honorable Court. It is not something which will be considered, which is because there is no record. So these are all original proceedings. What I can exemplify is that I've been sitting on the criminal roster, and I must tell all my younger colleagues, there is a particular kind of matters that we have, and I can share with Mr. Gupta also, that these are called protection matters. Protection matters. Protect my life and liberty. Protect my life and liberty. Repeatedly, every day we have 7, 8, 10 matters which are on this point. Now, as we read the petition, we do not find any incident which has been stated so as to cause an apprehension in the mind of the petitioner that there is some problem of life and some apprehension of life and liberty. So, but we do find out that yes, there must be something. So we also try to, because that's a matter which involving Article 21. But my younger colleagues, please do understand that all the judges do read these petitions. They find that some of the lawyers are doing it casually. If you sit with your client, if you will ask him time and again, there will be some incident, something. No, there's a petition which came out of all that I saw. One petition said that at 7:45, I received this call from so-and-so number and he abused me. And then on so-and-so time, when I was going towards so-and-so place, these two people I saw and I had an apprehension. So when you are making a petition, which is an original petition, please try to incorporate the exact details, the exact, to the last word, I would say, to the last day, date, etc. Because that gives a lot of confidence in the mind of the judges who would want to issue notice, etc. So your pleadings are very, very, it has to be very, very minutely and accurately done. Now, we have seen that these petitions which are filed, by and large, in a writ petition, obviously, whatever you have to say in the affirmative, you must say it. If you have gone and given a representation and the representation has not been accepted, what time did you go, to which officer you given, how did you come back, and all those factors must be mentioned in the writ petition, so that if you are faced with any query as to why you come so early after a representation has been filed, or as to whether did you actually represent or not, so all those things you are able to answer, and you do not lose on a technical issue on one of these aspects or lack of drafting. So as far as now the drafting part is concerned, that is one aspect. The other aspect that I would like to highlight, and I think I probably, hopefully as usual, not overstep my time, is the presentation part. Let me just come back to the presentation part. In the presentation part, now once we have a matter prepared, we have seen lawyers who come up in a pair thinking that they have prepared the matter so they know it inside out. They don't need to read it again. But my brothers, today you may be doing matters which are not very bulky, which are not very contentious, but prepare yourself that you will be the lawyer of the future. You will be the one who will be doing these contentious matters. For that, please read the whole file. For that, please mark as number one, assuming you have a particular point in mind, which you want to tell the judge. And that point is a point that something bad has happened, or something, I mean, protection of life and liberty, there's some incident has happened. Please note down the page. Stand up and tell the judge, please see page 3. At page 3, I have heard this. Then tell the next page. At page 6, I've said this. At page 7, I've said this. At page 9, I've said this. Take the judge with you. Make him, because even if a judge has to grant you relief, he would rather see the document and then be able to. Now, yes, we have some colleagues who like to argue orally. We have some colleagues who like to refer to the record and argue. But I can tell you, from as far as I am concerned, if there's a colleague, obviously we do appreciate oral arguments, and we do sometimes somebody so articulate that one really loves, you know, hearing our senior colleagues or younger colleagues are articulate. But the real impression, according to my understanding, that you can really create in the favor of a judge who's not read the file, or maybe it's an ordinary matter which has come up a little late in the day, is if you are able to show from the record whatever point you're trying to make out. If you feel that a particular thing you need to highlight, please, once you are well prepared with all the page numbers, you will be able to show those page numbers to the judge, and you will be able to then highlight the argument that you want to raise on the basis of the facts which you have shown to the judge. So the judge would be sure that before he passes an order, he would know, okay, these facts are there, they're in the documents. So one does not really need to, you know, doubt the fact that there is no such fact, or verify the fact. So in case you want to build up a point saying that your termination has been done because of some malafide reasons, and for that you have 10 documents to highlight that fact, take the judge as you get up by saying this is a malafide exercise. Please see page 7. This is the first thing. Please see page 9. This is so-and-so. Line number 3, line number 5, line number 7. Then, so for that, your preparation level has to be very high. So for that preparation level, whatever point you want to highlight, you must mention the page number in your own note, and similarly formulate as to how you're going to put it across, whether for that you need flags or you need to have it on your note right in front, so that when the judge is listening to you, hold the judge. Don't let the judge go left and right. The moment you will give him time, the moment you keep flipping pages, then the judge will start thinking about something which is against you, maybe something which is not maintainable. As they say, just hold the judge with you. Like Mr. Gupta, when he starts arguing, he only behaves the judge. Everybody is then just listening to him. And then, you know, appreciating the argument that is coming, because he's so well prepared in matters that one doesn't really want to think of anything else, except you're just hearing him and thinking what he's wanting to say. So do that. And once at a younger level, the best way we can do it is, obviously we don't have that much of legal equipment in the beginning. So we can just refer to the document which are a part of the record, so that you're able to then present it as best as you can. Sorry, I think hopefully I'm not running out of time, but I'll just take 2 more minutes. Can I do that?
Please, my lord, go ahead.
Yes. I'm sorry, I'm Mr. Gupta, hopefully I'm not holding everybody. The only thing is I should have gone a little slow because there's so much in my mind that I need to share. The judgment citing is, in fact, if I can just share that, I find a very few lawyers who are really able to really, really make out as to whether a judgment in a particular case is in their favor or is it against them or is it irrelevant. Now, how do we now go about it to have a better understanding as to when a judgment is in your favor and when a judgment is against you? Sir, it has happened with us. People coming from Delhi and engaging, top lawyers, top firms, they'll give you 30 judgments and say fraud vitiates everything. So what the judgment says is fraud vitiates everything. And they would say, in our case, there's a fraud. Fraud vitiates everything. Please take these 30 judgments and cite these 30 judgments. You would not believe, my experience has been, who does not know that fraud vitiates everything? The moment you're able to convince the judge that there is fraud in your case, believe it me that you will win the case. You don't need to cite a judgment on that. What you need to look at is, what are the facts of your case which you say constitute fraud? Now, assuming in your case, the only fact that is there is that the lady is a Pardanashi lady. And when she went for an agreement, that Pardanashi lady, that's the only one fact which has come in your favor. Rest, she went to the registrar, she got the document executed. There is a presumption of registered document against you. There is an endorsement of registration against you. So what is it then? So therefore, what you have to show to the judge is that this is my fact. So every case you'll have to come back to your fact. My fact is that there's a Pardanashi woman. Now, what judgment you need to cite is a judgment in which a Pardanashi woman, being a lady, being a Pardanashi woman, is a sole factor in which the court has held that in case she is a lady, Pardanashi, and she comes to the court and says there's a fraud with me, we will presume fraud in our favor. So this is what you need to cite to tell the judge that in absolutely similar facts or in lesser facts than in my case, the court has held it to be fraud and therefore set it aside. So now the judgment that is got to us is, in our case, there is no such fact. In our case, there's only a bald plea. And what we are citing is a fraud, in which case there is a fraud of the highest level. Maybe there's somebody carrying a pistol on the person's head and he's able to prove it, that he was taken to the registrar's office with a pistol on his head, some influence, something, etc. Or that, so ultimately now it comes down to this, that how do we understand that whether a particular judgment is in our favor or not? Now I'm coming back to the same fact. When you know your own facts very well, when you have read your record very well, you know. Now, let me give a simpler example. Let us talk about a person who is filing an admission matter. So you have read your case well. You know that your student is a student, the petitioner in your case, is a person who has got 90% marks, is a person who has got 90% attendance, and is a person who has attended, and a person who has got one gold medal, maybe say during his life. So you are seeking admission for that person. Now you come across 6-7 judgments where the High Court or the Supreme Court has allowed such admissions to take place. Now, as you're reading that judgment, let's not just read one paragraph out of the judgment that we are citing. Cite one which is relevant. As we start reading that, in the facts of that case, assuming it comes about that that boy had 89% marks, please mark that. So that's a factor which is a better factor in your case. Please keep reading the judgment further. Assuming his attendance is 91%, that possibly can't be highlighted. Mark it as a difference for your own understanding. Underline what is in your favor. Mark it as a difference or against what is against you. That's a factor against you. As you read further, the reply of the university in that judgment would be the best paragraph for you to read, because in the reply of the university in that judgment which you are citing would bring about whatever is bad about that boy. So actually, we need to see the converse. We don't need to see the petitioner's case. I mean, we don't need to highlight the petitioner's case that much, as much as we would highlight the respondent's case in that case. And once you see the response, because the respondent will come and say, oh, he has misbehaved, they will say something against the petitioner to oppose the petition. Please mark that paragraph. Highlight it to the judge by saying that in that case, oh, he had beaten up somebody also in the school. He had a criminal case against him, because all that will come in the reply of the university in that case. Then by the end of it, as you see what is the main reason given by the court in deciding that case. Assuming the main reason given is that because he had 91% attendance and nothing less than 91 is good, then the judgment is against you because you have 90%. And the court says that 91 is a mandatory thing that has to be done. Then the whole judgment becomes against you. But on the other side, if they say 91 and we hold that anything above 80 is good, then it's a judgment in your favor. But that fact is not in your favor because that fact, he is higher. So therefore we need to understand that what is the real law that has been laid down in that judgment and on basis of what facts that law has come about. There would be a judgment which would declare a law, which would cite a judgment that any person who's meritorious and above 80%, please keep him. Then the judgment obviously would apply to you and it will help you. But there could be a judgment which has been given on a particular fact after taking into consideration a particular fact as the highlighting factor. So you need to then compare that fact with your own fact. By the end of it, brothers, if you work very hard, there will be one or two judgments at the highest you will find, which will completely be on a particular fact be in your favor. And that's enough. If you have one with you, that's enough. Don't throw 10 judgments which are on general principles, which are on general points, without, and which in fact read carefully would possibly go against you. So ultimately my request would only be this, that as young lawyers, as we grow up in life, the learning part is an endless job. We have so many varied fields, be it civil, be it criminal, be it rent, be it that in all your life, you keep on learning. The only thing that we need to do carefully today is read our case inside out. Whatever petition has been given to us, whatever brief has been given to us, read every word of everything. Don't leave out any piece of evidence. Maybe that one line in a particular piece of evidence could give you the biggest point in your case. Don't leave out any document. And also, whenever you ultimately prepare a matter, if there is a point in your mind, always back up with a judgment. That's the time, if you'll back up, have a habit of developing a point from the record, and then you have the laptops, you have everything, search a judgment which is similar in that point. It will help you in knowing law in the process. It will help you in arguing the matter, and it will help you in even, you know, answering all queries of a judge. And if you're carrying a judgment on the point that you wish to agitate, you will be a lot more confident and you will also be able to justify your argument, and it will be difficult for a judge to immediately reject it then. So all that I say is that as younger colleagues, brother, don't look at too many cases coming in. The moment one case comes to you, prepare it so thoroughly that all people around you come to feel that this is a young, hardworking boy, young, hardworking girl. And that impression of people would help you getting more work by and by, slowly, slowly. The clients who come to you, If they feel that even if you've lost the matter, but if you have done put in so much of hard work, I can assure you they'll come back and they'll get more people for you in good times. And although I do understand the COVID times, I want to encourage all my younger brothers that the way you can make the best of this is that even if one matter comes to you in a month, don't get discouraged. Just prepare it to the best of your ability. Think God has given you more time preparing that matter so that whenever you appear in that matter before whichever court, the people, those who are watching you, the people who are opposing you, the people, the judge who's listening to you, should have an impression that this boy means business. He is here to stay. And rest all will follow. So thank you so much. I'm sorry. Sometimes in my excitement, I say things, which go a little overboard. I must tell all my younger colleagues, brothers, please do follow this. Please see Mr. Gupta. How is he today? Whenever, wherever he's arguing, I can tell you, it is a pleasure. I've done a couple of matters against him. And now I can tell you, Mr. Gupta, that I can on the lighter side. There was one matter I was doing against you, sir. You argued for 3 days. And the honorable judge, who would normally get up a little early, would sit through the day to hear Mr. Gupta. And after 3 days, I did not open my mouth because I was loving it. We were learning so much out of, the arguments and everything. So when I came back, my clients made a complaint to the person who had recommended my name. So that person called me up, somebody very, very, a very respectable person of Chandigarh. He said, Vikas, all is fine, but the clients are saying that you not even opened your mouth. And the other lawyer is a stalwart. He's arguing so well and you've not even opened your mouth, you said nothing. So then, the next day, if you remember, I got up and at 4 o'clock when we were all getting up, if you remember that day, although obviously it was there in my mind, I stood up and I told the court that there is no person better who can argue than Mr. Gupta and et cetera, and it was a compliment coming from the heart. But the advantage of that compliment was that when I came out and the judge laughed, he agreed, everybody in the court agreed that possibly we can't have a better counsel than Mr. Gupta. So the moment I came out, my client said, sir, very good. Hame samajh nahi aaya aapne kya bola. But sab has rahe the ji, aapne bola. Sab maan rahe the aapki baat. So a fact that I said in court, which was from the heart, made my clients also satisfied that you said something, but the judges agreed, the other lawyer agreed, and all the lawyers agreed. So I said, so this is how it is. You really love and you listening to Mr. Gupta and you want to listen all the time and you hear such. So because the preparation level, whatever may be his knowledge of law, that is there. But for every matter, the preparation level is to the highest. So that is what I would say, my brothers, please do that. Clients will flock at you. Client will run towards you. And everybody would want to engage you. You also think of a person the moment somebody says, whom should we engage? Okay, he can't pay that much. We think of a youngster who's thorough. We think of a youngster who does, a proper brief reading of the whole thing. Thank you, my colleagues. Thank you, my brothers. Thank you, my seniors, for being here. And God bless you and carry forward the good work that you are doing. And I hope that these tough times will pass and then everything would be absolutely for you to take. And thank you so much. I must say, the president, as well as the secretary and everybody for organizing this, the team. It's really a wonderful initiative. Please keep it up and please have it regularly. Thank you so much.
We are really grateful to my Lord for this enriching session. To the participants, I want to say that we have already shared a Google form in the message box. Please fill that form. I am sharing it again. Otherwise, you will not get the certificate. Certainly, if you wish to have the certificate, please fill that form. Now, moving forward, we have special guest of honor today, Dr. Monica Sharma, Principal Raith College of Law, having 17 years of excellence in teaching. She did her PhD in environmental law from Punjab University, Chandigarh in 2008. She has presented and published more than 50 research papers in many national and international conferences. She has also delivered more than 15 lectures in various workshops and seminars. It is also our privilege to have with us today Shri Anupam Gupta, senior advocate, an exceptional legal luminary and an inspiration for every budding lawyer. We welcome you, sir. Now we would like to hear from our guest, Dr. Monica Sharma. Thereafter, there would be a question answer session. whosoever wishes to pose a question to our honorable speaker, please raise your hand by using the option given in the Zoom application. Dr. Monica Sharma, please.
Good evening, everyone. Honorable Mr. Justice Vikas Behal, Mr. Dhillo, President, Bar Association, Punjab and Haryana High Court, Mr. Chanchal K. Singla, Secretary, Bar Association, Punjab and Haryana High Court, Mr. Anupam Gupta, Senior Advocate, and all the participants. I am grateful that you people have made me to participate in this seminar. The topic of the seminar was very catching, because as we people are aware that for law students, for law teachers, and for young advocates, it is necessary that they must have good communication skills. We all are aware communication skills does not only mean that we must have good spoken part, but we must have written skills also, because when we join the profession, client comes to us. If we do not know how to draft the case, then it is there are bleak chances that we will win the case. Therefore, it is necessary that along with spoken skills, we must have drafting skills also. As Mr. Justice has already gave us lots of tips that how we can improve our drafting skills, because without good drafting skills, neither we will be able to impress our authority who is going to listen us, and nor we will be able to impress our client. As for advocate, it is necessary that we must have clients, because if we will not have clients, then it is very difficult to earn our livelihood. For an advocate, it is necessary that he or she must get the clients. Therefore, I would like to tell all the advocates that and law students that it is necessary that we must have command over our communication skills, that is spoken part as well as written part. Only then we can succeed in this profession. Otherwise, it is very difficult. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for joining. It has been a privilege to receive you here. Now, I request the all the participants, whosoever wishes to pose a question to my lord, may kindly raise his hand. Earlier, I could see some hands, Mr. Balbir Saini, Mr. Rajesh Dhankar.
It's good, like judges always ask questions, you should also ask questions.
My lord, I have a question. In one of my RSA, I have difficulty with me. In fact, one of document is against me in the lower court proceedings.
Okay.
And I had challenged that on the basis of that document. I had challenged that issues which is against me in the RSA. And the lower court was summoned. In that document was not there in the original record. Oh. Then I had filed an application for secondary evidence. Even on the same date, my application as well as the appeal has been dismissed. So my question would be that, in fact, in case I raise this issue again, then what is the remedy because the finding of the judge was that you can file application before the concerned court, the court below.
No, brother, if I understand your question correctly, is your matter still pending before the trial court, or had you lost before the trial court? Did you have to file an appeal, etc.?
In fact, on the basis of that document, the findings was against me. That finding I had challenged in the High Court.
So if you have already lost and it's an appeal coming from an order passed by the trial court or by the appellate court,
application
which you had to file was an application under Order 41, Rule 27. That's an application for additional evidence.
In fact, that document was admitted by the other party, but the finding was given against me. That finding I had challenged in the RSA, and notice of motion was issued. Operation of the both the judgments were stayed, but at the time of final hearing, the record was summoned, and that document was not found in the original record. Then I had filed an application for the additional for the secondary evidence, but that application as well as my RSA has been dismissed on the ground that you can file this application before the Learned Trial Court. Though as per me, it was a case of remand back.
See, brother, now what you are saying is that a document was referred to in the judgment.
Yes, my lord. On that very document,
Was it exhibited in the judgment?
Yes, that was exhibited and admitted by the other party. That was the agreement too.
So therefore, which a document is, assuming a document was at some stage part of the or record, as per your plea, that is now today, after seeing the original record, not a part of the record.
No, it was a part of the record, but it was missing from the original record.
So brother, today as we take it, that is not a part of the record now.
Yes, my lord.
So either there is some kind of a mischief somebody has played. Obviously, for that, some kind of proceeding would be initiated if somebody is fudged with the record. Now, yes, the remedy that you have is, I understand, because the original must have been taken away.
Yes, my lord. Yes, my lord.
So you had to now, to really, because this is a very, very peculiar situation. Possibly, it would not have happened. I mean, it is one of a 1 lakh chance that is said. Possibly, as I see it, because now, today, the original record does not contain that document. So according to me, although it is already exhibited, already exhibited, there has to be an inquiry which has to be marked as to how come a document which has been stated to be an exhibited document considered by the courts below. And then, according to my understanding, you should have then seen the whole record, the evidence. There must have been some witness who must have produced that record, the document. One could have highlighted the evidence of that witness who had produced that document. Might have been some cross-examination on that document. There might have been somebody, an argument on the rebuttal side to that document. Please. So once Please. All that you could have shown, Please. Then that would have been that the document was there.
Please.
See, now today, since it has been lost, yes, once a document is lost, the original is not there. Then you Please. Have to make an application for secondary evidence.
That I have done so. But that application was also dismissed, my lord.
No, but now I have no application. So therefore, to my understanding, obviously with all respect to every person would have a different perspective and possibly something more would have been seen. If Please. That is the sole point and that document would have changed your case, then as per my understanding, the matter had to be remanded back because then on two aspects.
Please.
You had lost in both the courts, but.
Yes, my lord. Both the courts are against.
So it also depends, brother. It also depends as to whether that document or the document itself is such a wonderful document that it would call upon setting aside the judgment of both the courts below. Because apparently, as what you have told me, is that document was considered by both the courts.
Yes, my lord. On the basis of that very document, the finding was given. That finding I had a challenge. I am for the defendant in proceedings.
So you have a copy. You have a copy of the document. Is that document a document of a public document?
Yes, my lord. That is public document. On the basis of that, I have filed an application for secondary evidence before the Honorable High Court. But even date judgment, both the prayers have been discarded. Now I have filed the SLP that is yet to be listed.
As for my understanding, if that point was a sole, see that's what I say. Now you can never in an RSA you can never say that because of this point I would have won, but. If you are right, if that point was a singular point which could make you win and you had shown that it was already a part of the record, then in any case, relying upon the factor that their document is there and also your application, which is a secondary evidence application, bringing about the loss of the document being from the record, that concomitants of Section 565 are fulfilled. And if it is a public document, you must have an access certified copy of the document. You must have an access.
On the basis of that.
So then it's.
Yes, I have annexed that document.
So that application. See, that application has to be moved at the stage wherever you are. You can't move an application in a trial court when the matter is before the High Court.
Yes.
High Court is functus officio.
Yes.
So you have that to move it. Unless there is something else against you, which I would not know without reading the whole file. But on the singular fact, 65 should have been allowed on that. And but brother, we can't say without seeing the whole case, because
please,
if that document has been considered by the court and still you're not being granted the relief, that is a very big factor also against you.
Thank you very, very much, Mr. Sani. I would request all the participants to be brief and to ask only a relevant question relevant to the topic of discussion today. Now I'll ask Mr. Sunil Ranga to ask his question.
My lord, please. I'm very grateful to the bar as well as my lord that my lord is sharing his precious time, much precious time for us, my lord sharing all us. And I'm very grateful to my lord. And
oh, sorry, I didn't hear that part, brother. The last
part. I request the technical team to unmute Mr. Ranga.
Is Mr. Ranga unmuted? I think he's still on mute.
My lord, am I audible, my lord?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
My lord, I just want to ask one question, my lord. I'm a first generation lawyer, my lord. My lord, how could I be a judge? And my lord, to be a judge of the High Court, what should be my line of action, my lord?
God bless you. This is, see, people, those who think high, would ultimately move high. So, as I told you in the beginning, you know, there used to be a lot of anxiety with everybody that I must do 10 matters, 20 matters a day, 30 matters a day, have a lot of work. But by the end of it, brother, I can tell you today, since I've been sitting in the criminal roster, there were three, four advocates who have only appeared once before me. But they were so well prepared in their case that even if they don't appear before me for the next 10 years, I will still remember. This is one of the honorable judges told me. So whatever work you get, firstly, do that case to the highest level. Don't think about the next. Don't think about the how do I fetch more work. If one case has come to you, today you have time, prepare it so well, that take it as an opportunity that that whosoever sees you in that case, even in the beginning, if you're not very articulately able to put it, if you have your nerves, everybody has it. The best of lawyers were nervous when they did their first case. If you even fumble, don't worry. Each one of us has fumbled. But I can tell you, the judges can see through the preparation level. They will be able to see. Some people, you know, are very well prepared, but they start fumbling at the very, don't be concerned about it at all. A judge will, but sometimes you know that, you know, somebody is very flamboyant, somebody can argue well. So be very well prepared on the facts of your case. Be very well prepared in the way you present it. Carry judgments. Now, there's a one lawyer who's given me a booklet. He sent a booklet to us with page numbers. Try to make it as good, even if you don't got enough fees in that. It will be a kind of a way that you will start presenting yourself. People will take note of you. Whichever judge, I mean, if one judge takes note of you, sometimes, you know, there's so many 40 lawyers appearing, 50 lawyers appearing in a day. And if we don't even remember, I mean, who really was there, because most of the time there's nothing very good coming from the other side. So do that as first. Number two, stay superly honest. Remain as honest in your life as you can be. There would be a lot of situations where, you know, you are in some financial difficulty, something, and you might take up a matter which one would not take up if one is well provided for. Don't do that. Have faith in God. If you're hardworking, I can tell you, in this profession, you can earn as much, you can go to whatever level, but then you'll have to keep a very, very clean reputation. Advise your client that this case is not made out. Maybe at that time you'll go back, maybe that time you might feel that you've lost this case, but he will come back to you after he realizes that the case actually was not made out. So do that, and whenever a judge asks a question, always answer honestly. So these are the things. See, it's just not work that really, there's an impression that it's only work that, you know, maybe you will be carrying forward. It's your honesty, it's your behavior, it's your being fair to the court, and so many factors. Even if somebody does not have exceptional work, these four, five factors all mixed together really make out a person that you are. And if you stay like that, with the way that you're already, you know, thinking forward, and the way you have articulately put the question to me, I see a very bright future in you. And God bless you. Always dream high. Always live towards those dreams. But just work honestly. Work sincerely. Koi farak nahi padta, 10 lakh kamare ho, koi iska nahi hai, ya 1 lakh kamare ho. It doesn't make a difference by the end of it.
Thank you, Mr. Ranga. Mr. Shyam Panchmukh.
Respected Lordship and respected members of the Bar Association, Lordship, I want to ask that nowadays serial senior counsel and advocate appoint the junior, but the task they give to the junior is that to take the date and adjournment. So in such scenario, how junior can learn? Because this system has to be changed, because junior now been assigned a task of just getting the date and taking the adjournment, my lordship. That is my question to you.
That's a very relevant, very pertinent question. Brother, I must say, Shyamji, and all my younger people, sir, see what happens is, now let us go one by one. I had a junior colleague whom I thought is the 17th person, so I can't possibly interact. So what that person did was, and what I would advise you is, assuming your senior gives, you know that the next day there are two cases in which you might have to pair. The one case which you feel, or two cases that you feel you have to pair, read that case inside out. This profession is a profession which you learn on the basis of your self-maintained goals. Self, it is all your self-study. It is all your own routine. It is all your own self. Whether somebody is wanting you to work, somebody is threatening you to work, somebody is not wanting you to work, have your own routine. Decide for yourself that I am going to get up at 5 o'clock. I am going to read this matter in which I have to appear. And I am going to take out some judgment or some law with respect to this case. The moment you do that, when you come and interact with your senior, the senior will be able to see through that this boy has done something extra to the case. The moment you say, sir, I have this judgment, this case was given to me, I only have to take an adjournment, but I have seen the whole case and this is what my contribution is, there will be some confidence in your senior advocate. And slowly after 10, 15, 20 such incidents, if they happen, the senior would also start reposing some confidence in you. Now, one is, maybe still because of the fee that the senior has taken, he's not able to really permit you to argue the matter. Appear, when you're appearing in a court, just see, there are some judges who are, who encourage youngsters. There are some judges who might just ask you. And I can tell you, brother, if you are prepared in a case and the judge knows that you don't have to argue the case, and still you're able to, by chance, if the judge says, maybe it will happen once in 50 occasions. If the judge asks you a question and you are prepared, the impression that you will leave would be 10 times more than the impression that a senior advocate well-prepared would leave. For all times to come, a judge will feel that even in a matter he's not been paid, even in a matter he's not, and it has happened with some younger lawyers. Otherwise, all younger lawyers, they come and say, no, Lord, my senior has to argue. My this thing has to argue. Second, what you can do from yours, maybe that you don't get that opportunity in hurry. You, depending upon the judge, you also now need to know the judges. This is half of your advocacy is to know the judge, how fast he goes, how much he reads, how much he... So you say, Lord, although my senior, just say it. Say it before me. All right. Whenever you appear before me, just say it. Then, Lord, my senior has to argue the case, but I have prepared it. Will your lordship give me 2 minutes? I will see to it that I give you 2 minutes. You say it, that although I had, please don't. So no judge will dismiss the matter, knowing that, you are not the lawyer who's there. And it is somebody else who has to argue. Say it before the court. There will be a lot of judges who will entertain such a request and would rather be pleased by it. So that will show that you are wanting to work. So brother, how you take it forward?
Mr. Arun Goet.
Good evening. My question to your lordship is, what is the appropriate way of giving citations or judgments in a court?
See, brother, happens is, the best thing, the bare minimum, I would say, let me start from that, because there are people who are presenting it so wonderfully well, is that if you are citing 5 judgments on 2 different points, let us say 6 judgments on 2 points, make a full cover note, make the heading, and if you have 3 judgments, under a particular heading, make those 3 by a covering page. Have those same judgments, same citation with you. We have seen a lot of lawyers, they have 1 copy, they'll give it to the judge and then they will, because you can't lose time. When you are there to present your case, to get relief for your client, just don't lose time on whatever you want to present. So you make up your mind, which is the best judgment. Obviously, a judgment of the Supreme Court, if on a similar point, as compared to a judgment of a high court, that would rank first. Our high court judgment, as compared to the other judgments, would rank number 2. And a division bench would obviously be higher than a single bench. So prepare it in that manner. And put a covering page, flag mark the judgments from whatever first judgment finishes, second judgment, make it as presentable and make it as easy for the judge so that, you know, the bigger effort of the judge is in granting, you don't exhaust him, sir, he's only in reading it. Exhaust him in giving relief to you. So this is how you present it. Have at least one copy for yourself for the same citation, have one for the judge. And if you will, as you go further, have one for the opposing. That really, really, you know, sometimes this is really appreciated. And now people are having those spiral bindings, etc. I mean, there's no end to it, but for a young person, I think this is good enough. If he has a compilation with the first page, with the flags, if there are three judgments, just have three flags. So that one can see, okay, this is the judgment that you're citing. And put it in the copy.
Arun William.
A very good evening to everyone. The question is from my personal experience. Yes. That while arguing a regular second appeal, I argued for three dates. LCR was also summoned and the learned bench was also referring to the LCR. However, then the new roster came and the matter was listed before the new bench. And on the first hearing, being a young lawyer, I was enthusiastic to argue before the learned bench. However, without giving me much time to argue the matter, the learned bench dismissed the RSA on a single ground. I tried to raise different arguments. However, I was not taken seriously by the learned bench. So I want to ask my lord how to tackle such a situation, because such a situation is faced by the young lawyers a lot.
See, this is the biggest challenge of our profession. And as they say it, I must, because you're a younger brother, they say that you need to know your judge. And I can tell you, some people used to advise it, and I still see that. There are people, supposing you get a case of anticipatory bail, assuming somebody engages you. Before filing it, before going, go to every court. This is some of my friends used to do that. Go, assuming there are 10 judges sitting on the anticipatory bail roster. Go to every judge's court. See what does he do. See what is his opinion. See assuming it's a 307 case, as to what is the opinion of a judge. And whether he reads at home or not. How quick is he? Is he just wanting a? Do I need to just answer a query, or can I just present myself fully? Does he like to read the file, or does he like to hear it orally? Everybody is different. Everybody, a lawyer, I can tell you, is half as good as he knows the judge. This is what we were told also by our seniors. So, one is that. Second is, now RSA, yes, since most of my younger colleagues find it a little difficult to argue because it's a voluminous record. And it's a judgment which is of 40 pages. Once a very senior advocate asked me, why so much time is taken RSA? It's 40 pages or rather 80 pages against you. And that too by the judges who are having reasonable knowledge. District judges have reasonable knowledge. Trial court judges also have reasonable knowledge. So I answered back that you have a person who an administrative order passed of 4 lines. You have to get that set aside. We have to get set aside a judgment of 40 pages by 2 honorable judges. So, brother, one thing. As a lawyer, always you have to do your dharma. You have to do your duty. You should stand up. Don't get discouraged. Maybe it's the fate of the man. Maybe the client who has come to you is not an honest man, and that's why he suffered a particular judgment. Never take it on to yourself. Your duty is to prepare the case well. Your duty is to make an effort to present it well. But then that's why you are professional. Don't take it personally. Even on a particular day, maybe you lose the best case that you have. Maybe, but that's what is destined. So this is what my senior, Mr. Ashok Agarwal, told me. He said, this is the difference between a professional and a person appearing in person. Why do we have an advocate? We have an advocate because he has to act as a professional. Supposing you get too disturbed, then, you know, you will spoil maybe 6-7 days, you'll spoil your health. If you get too angry with the judge, maybe you will react in a manner that you might lose a court. So ultimately, this is all the destined. You know there are 10 judges sitting on a particular roster. One judge might dismiss a particular case. The other judge might issue notice and stay. So it's all destiny. It's not in your hand. What is in your hand is your preparation. So just leave it in the feet of God. Do your work and leave it in the feet of God. Bhagwan baithe, agar aap mehnat karoge, 100% you will succeed, brother. So take it like that. So I'm happy that you are concerned that you got dismissed. So you are a conscientious lawyer. Kuch nahi hota, it's okay. God will give you another opportunity. Maybe that was destined for him. Right?
So Mr. Nitin Verma.
I hope my Lord is not tired.
Not at all. In fact, I, you know, in the end, hurried up so much. I have, there's so much to say to my younger colleagues.
My Lord will hold another session. Whatever knowledge comes to us, it is a welcome, and it is welcome for every young professional.
I think your Lordship is not tired also.
No, not at all. As many, see, I can tell you. You see everybody's convenience. No, brother, I have finished my day's work, I can tell you. I just have to watch a couple of matches of IPL.
Mr. Nitin Verma.
Greetings, my Lord. Sir, I am Nitin Verma from Geeta Institute of Law, pursuing for BLLB, and I'm in third year of my course.
Oh, very good.
Actually, I was asking, sir, being a law student, sir, how can we get in touch with the judges so that we can do a judicial internships?
Hey, brother, what happens is, I can tell you, I was also in my first year of law when I started. First, you need to be interacting, or first you need to be going to an office of an advocate. See, what happens is, ultimately, it all has to start from there. And what I did was, I offered myself without any fee to one of the offices. Because, you know, at your age, sometimes, you know, it's a little difficult to really... I can share one thing with you. You know, both the colleagues who are working with me, they were both in the university. They both came as students. And they both, while as students, now we have three ways. Some people only used to fill up their forms and go back. Some never used to come. They used to say, please mark our attendance. We come for 2 minutes. These two kids, they came, they stayed back, they saw the cases, and we all started. And at that time, I had 15 younger colleagues with me. So they two both used to stick around. They used to see everything. They started even reading cases. They started even, and in one of the, I mean, yesterday they came back and said, sir, this one judgment is there in this case. I was shocked. And the moment I had to, you know, then ultimately have two colleagues with me, I offered it to them. And they both are with me. They both came as a student. And both were so anxious to work. So work with the lawyer. Slowly, how it works up is, and at that time I was a lawyer. So what happens is, brother, the moment somebody sees something outstanding in you, that person will also, because there's dearth of people who want to work hard. So if you're already thinking, get yourself associated to a good lawyer. Don't ask for any fee in the beginning. And somebody will see you, and somebody, if he sees that you are a hardworking, conscientious, and wanting to spend hours, don't worry, you'll be taken. All good people have been taken. I can tell you that. So you keep up. Keep up the positive.
Mr. Rajesh Dhankar.
Lordship, my question is slightly different than the today's topic. Your Lordship allows me, may I ask?
Yes, brother. Question. Go ahead, your younger brother.
Please, Your Lordship. If wife belongs to other state, then husband can file a habeas corpus in the state where he is residing.
Come again on this. If
Lordship, if wife belongs to other state,
okay,
then husband where he is residing can file a habeas corpus in the state where he is residing.
Habeas corpus, the main issue is the child. So now, if the child is in Maharashtra with the parent, whether the father or the mother, the petition should be filed in Maharashtra. See, what will happen is, ultimately, it is that court, this is my understanding. I may not be an absolute expert on this because I haven't analyzed this aspect. And the cases that we get over here is invariably either they are from Haryana or from Punjab. And the fight is such. So, but my understanding is that ultimately, going by the principle as to which authority can a court direct. A court can direct a Bombay High Court can direct the Maharashtra police or the authorities in Maharashtra or the person residing in Maharashtra to hand over the custody to you. But then there will be some debate on this. Assuming the child was taken from your custody in Punjab, and taken, then petitions can be filed in either situation. But I am not very sure on this proposition, but my understanding would be that where the child is there residing today, that is the court which will have the best jurisdiction.
Please, Your Lord.
Ma'am Stinder Kaur, our executive member.
Yes.
Your Lordship, my question is, many students have also asked in the chat that most of the time we have 7-8 points or pleas, and when to present the star arguments, because even the benches don't have much time, and without wasting a time, and it is a difficult question, always revolves around inside in our mind ki, that this question is star one, or when to present the star.
The star one question has to be number one without a doubt. Don't think that this is my ace, I will bring it up, you know, by the end of it. Your star argument has to be number one always, because the impression of a judge would be that if the star argument is so weak, maybe the subsequent would be even weaker. That is one. Second is, your star argument will be that argument which is not hyper technical, which is substantial. See, one is you're trying to win on a technical point. The other is you're trying to win on a substantial point backed by a judgment. So if you have two arguments or three arguments, out of which one is a substantial argument, the other is a technical argument, and you have backing of judgments in both, then the star argument would be the argument which is a substantial argument, which has a backing of a law. And I can tell you, if you can make out one point, 8 points are, you know, sometimes points are not, you just throw a point and then that's the end of it. Oh, I have nothing to cite, nothing to support in law. Point is a point which is supported by law or by a provision of law. Then 1 point is enough. I can tell you, in every court, I used to prepare 20 points, 15, but I have seen where I had a backing of law, the first point would work and nothing more. That's possible in the final arguments that sometimes 3-4 are to be agitated. One good point with backing of law. Don't think that point is, okay, you know, I have spent 7 months in jail. Okay, it's non-commercial. Okay, now that's not a point. That's just, you're just throwing something at the judge. Point is, no, my lord, I have spent 7 months. This is the law. This is what Supreme Court says. You can't look at any other factor. This is enough. So that's the point made. So always give it as the first point.
Thank you, sir.
I thank all the participants who have made this evening wonderful and this session a success. The Punjab and Haryana High Court Bar Association is highly indebted to Honorable Mr. Justice Vikas Behl, who has spared his valuable time and have been our constant support earlier as Honorable Member of this Bar and now an Honorable Member of the Bench. It is not out of place to extend our gratitude towards Honorable Mr. Justice Arun Pally for his inspiration and motivation to execute this initiative. We will be holding our next workshop on 9th October 2021 on a new topic with a new expert. The Bar Association will make an endeavor to associate all the honorable judges of this court in the coming workshops. Thank you everyone for sparing valuable time. And thank you, my lord, for giving us such a wonderful insight of the law and also enriching us, even these not so young members of the bar. Everyone has learned from my lord, and we are highly grateful.
The president and secretary look the youngest and the smartest. Eh? So thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me. And thank you, my brothers and my sisters. Thank you. God bless.
Thanks a lot.
Okay. Take care.
हाँ जी।